Our talk discusses and hopes to illustrate a very simple premise. And that premise is that machine learning is more suited to offensive. In other words, it's more suited to attackers than it is to defenders. Now, I know that's a very bold statement. That's a big statement to make. And hopefully the talk will illustrate that statement, and at the end of the talk, you'll agree with us that it actually is the case. So I do know in talks like this, it's quite traditional to have images of robots staring thoughtfully into space against a black background that's blue. I'm sorry, we have none of those images. So Wicus and myself went a different way of imagery. So in no particular order, we've got some Zulus, Maasai warriors, ants, realtors, walking dead zombies, because they're cool, right? And of course, no cybersecurity presentation is complete without an image of a cat. So we've got some cats too. I think that the full set there, I think. So let's talk about the journey that led us to and through this presentation. This all started with Wicus and myself trying to scratch a rather annoying itch. And that itch was this, is that a lot of commentators said what I said in the introduction, that machine learning and AI is more suited to offensive than defensive applications. Yet, we see little evidence of all those offensive applications. We heard this morning in the keynotes about four times people saying that machine learning is more suited to offensive than defensive applications, but there's not a lot of it out there. And we hope to scratch that itch using the librarian of machine learning. So the librarian of machine learning is topic modeling. Very unloved, but a very powerful technique nevertheless. And for the record, I think librarians are, they're pretty cool. I like librarians. So it's nice to use librarians in a presentation. So of course, when librarians become evil, they become even cooler. So we'll show you some examples of librarians becoming evil. And we'll finish by looking at where this might go in future. Okay, is that a good journey? Good, let's start. So let's start by examining this hypothesis that machine learning is more suited to offensive than to defensive applications. Gives me a good excuse to have a cat on there too. It's a cat African style, I think. So let's look at this hypothesis, and to do so, let's do a quick recap of supervised versus unsupervised learning. The reason I want to do that is that it goes to the heart of why machine learning is more suited to offensive than defensive applications. So let's look at supervised machine learning. So first of all, with supervised learning, I've got a lot of data, but I've got labeled data. And what I do, in essence, I'm trying to teach a mathematical function to predict the labels given the data. And I do that by normally splitting my setup in a training set and a validation set, and I teach my model to predict the labels using the training set, and I test it with the validation set. Now, the key thing here is this, is that for this technique to be effective, the data that my model will see later needs to look the same as the data I trained it with. And here's the thing. In cybersecurity, we do not have good data sets. I'll share some of the data sets that a lot of researchers use when they train these supervised models. The first set is DARPA 1998. You heard that right, 1998. Then you've got KDD 99, you have ISC 2012, and you've got ADFA 2013. That data is not representative of the modern state of the art of security. So no wonder that we often struggle with these supervised machine learning models, because they're really not representative. Now let's look at unsupervised learning. So with unsupervised learning, I don't have any labels. So all I'm trying to do here, I'm trying to understand structure of the data. And how do I do that? I normally start with a model. I might start with a model like, a clustering model, a Gaussian mixture model, LDA. And what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to infer the parameters of the model given the data that I'm seeing. So I'm not assuming any structure in the data. I'm just trying to understand, I don't have any labels. I'm trying to understand the structure in the data. And of course, we use unsupervised learning in a number of cases where clustering is a good example, trying to group log files together, or in our case, we will use it to understand structure in text documents with topic modeling. Okay. So now given what we just a quick recap, let's look at this hypothesis in a bit more detail. You know, why is it more suited to offensive than defensive? So to do that, I think I'm going to try to represent the world using some icons, okay? And I think this is probably the RSA first for Maasai and Zulu icons, which I quite enjoyed. No hoodies here, which is quite nice. So of course, we've got the attacker on the left-hand side, and he's a frowny face. We've got the defender, nice open face, you know, nice Zulu bandana on there, and we've got the world. Now, of course, it's attacker's job to phish, deceive my users. You know, they want to exploit vulnerabilities. They want to persist. You know, they effectively want to get into the network. And my defenders, it's their job to educate my users, to have safe defaults, you know, to have authorization, authentication, and to educate my users. So, and now the attacker is trying to evade the defender, and the defender is trying to detect the attacker, okay? Now, and this is a key thing. My users don't change adversarially. So think back of the recap of supervised learning, where it works well if the training set looks the same as the data set we'll encounter later on. So actually, it's very well suited to our nice attackers there. But they can train the models using the behavior that doesn't change. On the other side, my attackers change all the time. They respond to what the defenders are doing. So they're not really suited to machine learning, and which is why a lot of times people will use unsupervised learning on the defense side. So of course, the worst place to apply machine learning is at that point we're trying to detect an attack, because it does not reflect the training data we'll see later. The training data does not reflect what it will actually see when the attackers are attacking the network. So this is really comes to the heart of why we make this statement. Okay, so again, I made the statement that it's more suited to offensive than defensive applications. So where are all those attacks, if this is the case? And that's exactly the itch we were trying to scratch with this presentation. So let's look at where we are today with offensive. And again, we heard it this morning a lot. So the current state of art on the offensive side seemed to be around image recognition, either fooling image recognition using random pixel manipulations, or trying to create fake images, you know, for identity fraud. There's quite a lot of work at the moment around phishing, you know, automated phishing using natural language processing, or also using pattern recognition to find vulnerabilities in libraries. And those are the current state of the art where a lot of the stuff is going on. But the reality is a lot of those attacks aren't easily reproducible. They're not scalable. And they're very much in the realm of theoretical at the moment. And that's what we wanted to change with this presentation, to kind of demonstrate some attacks which you can go away with and play with, demonstrate them. In fact, we talk about it a little bit later, but all the tools we'll be discussing today will be on our GitHub page. So to go out there and enjoy it. So just putting it out there. So how do we get to the attacks, okay? And how the journey started for me and Wicus was with features. It all started with features, okay? We all love features. You know, features are fantastic. You know, new features on our smartwatches, new features on our software. Our vendors love features because it gives them reasons to sell us more stuff or to, you know, to justify the subscription models. The thing, though, is with features are that very often they lead to unintended consequences, where features are abused because systems become more complicated and we have situations where we can't predict how features will be used. So, give an example of that. You know, a good example in the cybersecurity world is around email attachments. It used to be that email attachments were executables, which were bad, and people got told not to use those bad email attachments. Then we moved on to Flash and PDFs. But now we are in a stage now where we're starting to see feature abuse of things like Office, which leads me on to this thing called DDE. So DDE is Dynamic Data Exchange. It's that wonderful feature that you have within Office that if you open a document, it says, this thing has got external data sources. Do you want to update the data source? You go, yes, yes, give me my data. You know, you click through those annoying warnings to get the data. It's not a, doesn't require a macro. It's not a feature, it's not a bug, it's not an exploit. It's a baked-in feature within Office. So the thing is, how might you abuse that feature? Now what you see here is a valid cell you can put into Excel. So just take a second to look at that text there. If you strip away all the syntax, Excel, when I open that document, will connect to an external server on the internet, download some content, and run it on the local machine. Why? Why do you think that's a good idea? Nevertheless, you can do that within Excel. Okay, let me just show you what happens when that happens. So what you see here on the right is my machine. I've got my little spreadsheet, which I'm going to just open for effect. On the other side, on the top there, you've got the command and control server. At the bottom, we've got the web server that's going to serve the evil content to my machine that opened Excel. And you'll see here, just a normal user. It's part of our SensePost, our research labs. We're going to open, just to show you who am I. I'm SensePost. And next step, we're going to open the spreadsheet. Of course, nothing will happen on the machine, except you'll notice there's a connection to my web server here. Annoying warnings, external update, yes, 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 give me my data, please. And of course, here, there's a connection to my web server. It's serving a payload. And next minute, there's a connection to my CNC, which now has some level of control on that machine. So this is what happens when you abuse features. So Microsoft announced that as an AI-first company, they're going to introduce ML on the desktop. And that was the moment when I thought, whoa, imagine having that power on the desktop, having that features on the desktop. Where might that lead? That would be kind of cool, wouldn't it? And that's what started the process of thinking how you could act offensively on a desktop. Now, of course, Wicus being Wicus, the first thing he did was to demonstrate how he could actually use in the early release of Windows these libraries without Windows Defender picking it up, kind of almost using Windows against Windows. But, you know, that's for future talks, you know, because that will be released in future Microsoft's Windows 10. So what we then did is we said, okay, what if we use machine learning on the desktop? What will this allow us to do? Which leads me nicely onto my librarian. Okay, so topic modeling. So, of course, you know, as I said before, we wanted to turn our librarian into a little bit evil, even cooler, nicer. No. And we constructed two attacks. Now, the code for the attacks will be available afterwards, and the address will be in the presentation later on. I do ask you, please be kind. When you look at the code, you know, I started with Fortran. This is Python. It's different. It's not what I'm used to. So be kind, please, you know. But it's up there for scrutiny and enjoy. And also, I'm a tabs guy. I'm not a spaces guy. Grew up in the era of tabs, okay? So be kind. So given that we're going to use topic modeling as attack vector, let's do a quick whistle-stop tour of topic modeling as a discipline. What is topic modeling? So the slides, the next three slides, come from a machine learning course from Prof. John Paisley at Columbia. So thank you, Prof. Paisley, for allowing me to use your slides. That's very kind of you. So let's look at topic modeling very, very quickly. So topic modeling allows you to model. First of all, topic modeling is a unsupervised machine learning method, and it allows you to model text effectively. So what it allows you to do is to look at a whole bunch of documents and understand what the themes is across those documents and also what the main theme is in a document without having any knowledge of the document itself. So all you give it a bunch of text, and it's able to extract what the main topics are and what the most dominant topic is in that document. Now, from an attacker's point of view, that's nice, because I don't have to understand anything about my target, but I can get some structure and understand what's going on in that network, what documents are in there, what are they discussing. And how does it do that? It does that by, first of all, almost looking at which words occur the most. And then it will look at which words occur together the most. And it's a generative model, and it will use the Richelieu distribution for words, and then it will use the LDA algorithm with variational inference to discern the models. But that, at the end of it, what you'd get is this. You get a list of words that occur together the most, the topics, and for every document, you'll get a distribution of topics. In other words, what's the main thing that gets discussed in every document? So that's topic modeling. So now, given that we understand topic modeling now, how do we turn this into an attack tool? So there's two attacks we want to demonstrate. And again, the focus here for me was on two things. I wanted to illustrate that hypothesis that it's more suited to offensive than defensive. So the attacks needed to be scalable, and they needed to be reproducible. Anybody in this room should be able to go away and play with these attacks, because otherwise the hypothesis does not hold. It's something that people keep saying, but with little evidence of these pesky attacks. So those are the two key things for us. And so really for me, it's about industrializing. Type of squatting is one attack, and the second attack is trying to understand structuring documents and exfiltrate documents in a network that's of interest to me up front. Which now leads me on to Wicus. I'll introduce Wicus. Wicus is our head of research for SecureData Labs, and Wicus had the beautiful task of translating my mad ideas into some proper attacks that he can demonstrate and show. So take it away, Wicus.
Thank you, Etienne. So what do we mean by offensive? Demonstration without talking about it is not going to be really a demonstration, right? So what we did is we went and set, or Etienne's brainchild, we went and created a program, software, writing it quickly. Not a lot of work went into it. To give you an idea, it was like 30 lines of Python code. Etienne mentioned Python code, which was actually quite also a relief this morning when I heard McAfee was also using Python to do their ML POCs. The reason why we chose Python, because it's easy to get going, and there's quite a mature set of modules in there. Modules like the sklearn, natural language toolkit, gensim, spacy, etc. So these things have already been vetted, it's matured, and we could just use these modules with very little effort on our side. And then you write the code and you write it against your machine, and what is quite interesting is you see actually verified topics. So in other words, I know what data I'm looking at, I know what I'm looking at, and verifying our topic model, it actually reflects that. So we were actually in the ballpark here. So what was important for us here is to say, well, if we're going to demonstrate this in an attack, how are we going to do that given that it's Python? Now, Python's got a limitation in the fact that it's a runtime interpreted language, which means there's quite a lot of ecosystem that you need to carry around doing that. So that was overcome using something called Py Installer, which just packages it for us. Now, it's not very efficient in size, but for us, for this demonstration, it's quite effective. And so our librarian was born. Now, Etienne tasked me to turn this librarian. So how do I turn the librarian to the dark side? For this demonstration, we're using something called Cobalt Strike. Now, Cobalt Strike is a commercial tool that they use for adversary simulations, typical red team assessments, pen tests. What it enables you to do is act like an attacker. You can act like a hacker. You can do all your lateral movements and set up infrastructure and do all sorts of things with it. The main reason why I used Cobalt Strike was it allowed me to do some scripting. So Cobalt Strike is not important for our topic model AI demonstration. It is more just there to script stuff for us and to do stuff for us. Right. So the attack has got a premise. We need to get the user onto the user's machine. And to do that, we use something called a watering hole attack. Now, for those that don't know what a watering hole attack is, there is basically a trusted website, a legitimate website that has been compromised. We insert some malicious content there. Users don't know the website is compromised. They click on a link, they download stuff, and once again, like Etienne said, people sometimes just click stuff, run it, And there we go, we got a foothold on your machine. So in this case, the user clicks the link, downloads the content, and connect to our COBOL strike command and control. Now, we can talk about it afterwards, but that attack actually is a legitimate attack. And it's also a feature abuse, full feature abuse, nothing to do with 0 days, 0 days, whatever. It's purely user manipulation and using certain features available to Windows desktop users. Once it's hit our command and control, our topic model will be downloaded using the script, and then everything from there just rolls automatically. Once it hits the desktop, it will start doing its topic modeling. It will identify documents, run through the network drives, if there are any network drives, and just start identifying it and grabbing documents that match our principal topics. Also, this video is going to flow quickly, so you can keep up if you want, but I will narrate. The person clicks on the link. Apparently nothing happened after they opened the document, but that's not true. That payload was downloaded and now connected to our COBOL strike interface. Here we can see, we can interface with that user. We're on their desktop, and we can do whatever our next intentions is. The COBOL strike script that we created is now actually busy running in the background, trying to update and so forth. It's doing all this stuff. While that's doing running, let's just look at some settings. Not that important, but the last one, the principal topics, is the most important part for our demonstration. The principal topics we listed there, we're going to say we're interested in network configuration, infrastructure, and passwords. So any document that's related to a topic group that has those words in it, our principal, our most dominant words that we're interested in, is going to be downloaded for us by our COBOL strike. So in other words, the librarian is now being turned against the user, and it's serving our needs. So for us, that means we don't have to go and run around the network downloading all their documents and then going through that trove of documents and discern it. So while it's running, it's now busy, it's going to download it, and you'll see it's going to drop onto the desktop. Now it's verified it. So in other words, it's there. It's going to run after it's detected the drive. So it detected two network drives maps in addition to the My Documents folder. It's going to scan. We edited the video just in the interest of time to speed things up where it takes a bit slower. So here we can see it's now running in the background. So now, looking at our process graph, it's sitting there. It's not very stealthy, but for us, it's just effective. It's running. It's running there. It's now scouring your network for documents. It's identified four topic groups that matched our principal topics. So we're going to look at that now. So while it's now running, and also it identified 3,433 documents that matches that. All right. So while we're looking at this, imagine these documents are now being exfiltrated in the back. So here we're just highlighting the four groups that we identified. It's group 4, 2, 1, and 0. And the two words it triggered on, the two principal topics, is network and configuration. So that already gives us context. All right, we're now going to have a curated list of documents that is in line with what we were looking at, which means, once again, we can now at our leisure peruse through that set of documents. And we'll go through to the download section. Here, also, we just had to highlight or blank out some of the sensitive documents that was running on our network. But it gives you an idea. This is stuff that's just being pulled in by a COBOL strike for us. Now, these documents are not at the moment sitting on our side. It's sitting on the COBOL strike team server, which is a central location, which means other team members of my APT group can now also look at the same documents I'm looking at. But for now, let's just select a couple of documents and look at them. The content of the document for now is irrelevant to us. You can just scan them and just see if there's anything of interest to you. But what we'll see here is that these documents is in line with what we are trying to, you know, find. In the beginning, when we looked at this, we realized it is, you know, it makes our lives quite easy because I just have to sit there and get my topic model to run and just collect documents. In this case, we were running against over 30,000 documents, close to 40,000 documents, 300 gigs worth of data that I didn't have to go download and exfiltrate and then decide what I'm going to do with it. I now had a very small subset that I could easily and quickly get hold of. In this case, this document is a bit dated. 2011, I think, which means it's like, yeah, it's not that relevant now, right? 7 years later, eight years later. But we'll see later there's some more interesting stuff. But it gives us a sense that our topic model, our librarian, has already started identifying stuff for us that is of interest. And other aspect I think that was not illustrated, that you will not see at the moment in this video, is imagine while we're doing this, other users go to our watering hole. Other users click those links, download those things, and just get added to our Cobalt Strike server. Our infrastructure just automatically start deploying these topic model scanners. Our librarian is just doing indexing work for us, go finding these things and start exfiltrating these things with very little effort. The efficiency level that comes into that is a sense that we don't have to do a lot of work. Our attacker is lazy. Our attacker just opportunistically grabbing people or actually now can decide how they will use this content to either spearfish people or maybe look at that infrastructure and actually go and maybe now attack that because they got now internal information. But this could be any information. It can't not necessarily infrastructure information because this was run against our network. And obviously the content is specific to our industry that we're in. The point being is, like in this case, my eye caught something there because it had the word forensics in it. I didn't even know that that document was on our network. And then I actually went to look what it was. And I actually saw it was a design for a network for one of our clients doing forensics, which was quite, yeah, the score. That's quite nice. And once again, the attack, I want to illustrate the point is that this attack is all about creating context. And it's all about getting a curated set of information that we can play with. Looking at efficiencies, Etienne mentioned .NET. So the Python one is not very efficient. It still has a bit of work to do. Getting into the machine learning libraries, that's going to be on Microsoft. I don't have to carry that payload with me, which means my payload now becomes a lot smaller and more efficient, and I can run on that machine with whatever Microsoft allows me to run. All right. And just wrapping up here, one of the things that also Cobalt Strike allows us to do is just clean up behind us. So now we've removed ourselves from the network. We've now stepped away. And that allows us to just, you know, decide later. Or we can actually now do lateral movement or whatever, or go collect more documents from that same network. Etienne.
Thank you. Thank you, Wicus. You know, every now and then, when you do something like this, you have that, like, whoa moment. We had this idea, and when we started running topic modeling against networks, and it was able to tell us what the documents were and what the main things are they were discussing. We went like, eek, this could be quite a powerful thing. And what was interesting for me, this is a new form of attack. This is a data-driven attack. It's not an infrastructure-driven attack, which is something that's a little bit different. Let's talk about our next attack. And this is about typo squatting. So typo squatting effectively is the attack it's well known, but you register a whole bunch of domains with the hope that people will fat finger email addresses, misspell, mishear, and you'll receive a lot of documents that's interesting information in it. Stuff that's misdirected that comes to you. And it's quite a well-known attack. And in this case, we wanted to use it in the real estate industry. Why? Because in the real estate industry, it's very well known because there's high-value transactions and it's sometimes called the Friday afternoon fraud. What happens there is that the attacker tries to get between the solicitor and the realtor, and they try to misdirect the funds flow, but when the funds flow. Very well-known attack. So how would you construct a typo squatting attack? The first thing is you enumerate your players. Who are the people I'm targeting? In this case, we're picking on realtors. You know, I love realtors, but you know, you have to pick on something. So we picked on them. So we looked at some London-based estate agents, as they are called in the UK. And it's quite easy to get a list. The next thing is to predict how people might misspell their names. And all the common things, search engine optimization tools will actually tell you how people might misspell domain names. So it's quite simple. Don't even have to guess. You tell it how they might misspell it, mishear it, fat finger it, and so forth. You then go on and you register all those domains on the mail server. Very simple. And then you just wait. And I'll tell you what, it does not take long before we start getting some really interesting emails. In the case here, this is now a solicitor emailing a realtor or estate agent saying, I've been instructed in the sale of a £3.3 million house. So not small transactions, okay? So a very effective attack. The challenge of this attack is how do I scale it? Now, That's a cool picture of ant, isn't it? It's probably the coolest picture of ant I've ever seen in my life. So how do I scale these attacks? Because what you just saw there required quite a lot of trawling through, a lot of emails. And top tip, by the way, those emails aren't going through AV system. So do not run this in your work machine. You're going to get yourself lots of viruses. It does not go through mail hygiene. Okay. So, and the question is, how do I scale these attacks? How do I actually identify which mailboxes are interesting, which ones have documents in that might be valuable that I could actually use information from? Which brings me back to Wicus.
Thank you, Etienne. In this attack, we are no longer requiring a COBOL strike to do our work for us. What we just did is take the same code that we had with using in COBOL strike example and just put a graphical user interface onto it, just to, first of all, get more visualization on it, and also allow us to tweak the settings a bit easier, less command line driven. But the visualization aspect is the most important part here. And also, just a note, there's going to be a lot of text going to fly across here because you just have to get through this demonstration quickly. But feel free to try and spot stuff there that's interesting. And just listen, I'm just going to narrate us through that. So before we start, I'm just going to tell you what we're going to do. We're going to look at the user interface first. Then we're going to go and look at some of the type of squatting emails and how that maps to our topic models that we've found. And then we're going to look at attachments and so forth in there. Also, we can look at, I'm going to spy on Etienne's email sent items as well as the executive PA's sent items box, just to give you an idea what we're going to do. And then while we're doing these things, all it does is just vectorizes the text, gives it to our topic model, and then visualize the results for us. We can also save that at a later stage. So we're not going to win any Apple design awards here, but we are just engineers that want to play with stuff. So these are just features that we have in our simple graphical user interface. And this maps directly to these libraries in Natural Language Toolkit, Spacey, LDA, etc. Here we can see we can configure lemmatization, the count vectorization, etc., even regular expressions. If you need to. In this case, we're going to do latent derelict allocation with all its settings there, all the knobs and bobs that we can tweak it on. And finally, if we want to save any LDA viz visualizations, we can use that as well. So let's look at some examples. In this case, we're going to just load a session that we've already processed for you just to save some time. And this is one of those realtors that Etienne was talking about. And we're just going to run it, and it's going to give us some visualizations. Like I said, it's just going to give you an idea. So we can, all the groups there, and you can look at this quickly. You can see interesting frequencies, the lighter color and the darker color being the weighted, being the more important stuff. Word clouds, if you scan through there, you can see they talk about cleaning vacuum cleaners. They talk about tenants and service and contracts, etc. So you get a quick overview. You can get that. Looking at files. That's interesting. In this case, topic group one maps us to one of the exported type of squatting mails. And here we can see there's a solicitor with an instruction also to do a financial transaction. Similar case, let's go find something a bit more juicy. Here we see one with a lot more information, a lot more sufficient information that you can use in, like Etienne say, insert yourself in that attack. Visualization with LDA viz, standard stuff available with the Python library set. Larger circles being more weighted, more important for us, and in the right-hand side bar graph, giving us more weights and frequency distributions of those words. So when we don't know what we're looking at, when I was running this, when you run this against Etienne's sent items box, we can see what he was busy with, his RSA work, merchant acquisitions, CTO minutes, and the executive PA, bottom left, if you couldn't spot it there, the champagne, bottles, etc. So somebody was planning a Christmas party. It just gives you an idea. You don't know what you're looking at, and you get context quickly, but it's just by scanning through somebody's stuff. And finally, this is a document that we found in our campaign that actually relates to a South African financial institution that had quite a sensitive transaction going, secondary trading of loans, etc. And this is just stuff that's sitting there that gets broadcasted around, and if you're type of squatting and you have your topic model running, you can grab the stuff. In this example, it's a gambling license that's under discussion in this document. And just running it through our topic model, you could actually pick these things out and quickly get a sense of what's going on. And here's an example of a comment of one of the lawyers on that, and I think it's relating to greyhound racing for the specific document that was discussed. So the point here being that this is like doing without any, without doing a lot of work, without just sitting there and you getting emails, thousands of documents attached to these emails, and you just have to run your topic model against that. It tells you what you're looking at. You tweak it if you want to look at specific versions of topics. Otherwise, you can just like, I want that, I want that, I want that. So you get context. And the scalability comes through is, I don't have to go scroll through lots of spam. I don't have to read all those emails and all those documents. There's a GitHub page. You're welcome to go and clone that. If there's anything relating that you would like to know more, please let us know, and we can give you some feedback on that. Thank you, Etienne.
And if you want to improve the user interface, feel free. You know, I told you I started with Fortran. I think it shows when you look at that interface. So I guess the question is, where does this lead? Okay. Now, the bit that Wicus talks about there for me, which was particularly interesting, was the unknown unknowns. When I'm going after stuff that I don't know what I'm looking for, but this will tell me very quickly that it is interesting or not interesting. In that transaction that Wicus showed you, it's for a public company. That transaction is not concluded yet. That's quite useful information. And I didn't know I was looking for it, but it allowed me to get to that very, very quickly. So where does this lead? I guess the first thing for me is this, that I do believe that these attacks are scalable, they're reproducible, and they're real. You can go and do it. So in my mind, this notion that machine learning is more suited to offensive than to defensive is proven. We've shown it. And I do think that we have to adapt our threat models to take that into account. And I think we need to start thinking about different forms of attack, like data-driven attacks, not just infrastructure-driven attacks, not just using machine learning to automate what we do today, but maybe bringing machine learning to the part in a slightly different way. And that's a big thing, actually. I guess the next thing is that, how do you counter this? Endpoint telemetry is your friend, I think. Things like Sysmon, looking for feature abuse, you know, trying to understand when processes are accessing a large number of files. You know, I think these things are useful in trying to detect these kind of attacks. Now, for the attacker, this was very, very useful, because they allowed them the ability to see what's going on in your network in a way that you perhaps don't know. They could identify interesting documents, themes in these documents, where they were. I think it's quite useful to do that yourself. At the moment, I think most DLP implementations use very rudimentary ways of identifying documents. They use hashes, they use, you know, regular expression, key phrases, and that's not really, really effective. Topic modeling is much, much more effective to map and understand what's going on your network. So use it. Those tools have been made available. You can actually scan your network, attach drives. It will tell you what's on your network. It's quite useful as a defensive tool, too. I guess I mentioned this already. I do think this opens up a new class of attack. And to finish on that point again, I do think these attacks are very plausible. And, you know, it didn't take us that long to actually create these attacks. You know, once we had this little itch we wanted to scratch, it didn't take that long to actually create. So I guess that leads to the point, do have a response plan ready. Really do. It's important you do. It's just a matter of time. It's not if, it's when these attacks will start going mainstream. So what next for us? I guess future work. The type of squatting stuff that Wicus showed you, I think you could really automate and scale that by saying, I'm only interested in documents whose principal topic are the following things, and only send me those documents. Then I have to do nothing. Just register domains, mail server, let it do the rest for me. I think that could be a really interesting way of attacking stuff. The next thing is, I guess, is to maybe make it slightly more structured for defense, this whole mapping area, helping administrators understand where stuff is. I guess, in our threat detection practice, this is topic modeling is extremely useful to scan forums, no dark webs here, but you know, scan pastebins, forums, to see what topics are discussed when your company's name is mentioned. This could be quite useful. And I guess the last step is to do what Wicus talked about, which is to really use Windows 10's libraries to form these attacks. So I guess we're going to leave some time for questions, but the one thing I do want to finish on is this. I do think we've shown how you could use machine learning as an offensive tool in a scalable and reproducible way. So I hope you agree with me that I think we've proven our hypothesis that actually machine learning is more suited to offensive than to defensive applications as we stand here today. So here's our Twitter, Twitter handles. You know, as South Africans, we feel obliged to want to dice or get more Twitter followers than Elon Musk. So any bit of help, any help is really, really appreciated. Thank you. And if you do, you know, follow us, you know, we can send you the links to the GitHub page if you weren't able to photograph it, you know, in time. But, you know, hit us up and we'll send you the link. But I think we've got some time for questions. So we left 10 minutes for questions, yeah? Any questions, thoughts, observations? Oh, there's one. Perfect.
Yes. Hello. Thanks for the great talk. I really enjoyed it. My name is Julian Kallas. I'm from Ericsson. Okay. I wanted to ask you, even though it's quite true what you're saying, that it's more, machine learning can be really exploited for offensive attacks. Many of the things you mentioned, I think you can also counteract them, for example, with anomaly detection. There's many models that help you train on even normal data. You don't even need to think what the attacks are going to look like.
Yes.
In a certain way, you can profile things as normal behavior and then just hope that the model is going to detect the attacks. What is your opinion on this, for example?
You know, I don't know. Recursive Bayesian estimators has been used by a very famous company based in the UK. I have my view on those things. I think you get a lot of false positives with them because effectively they anomaly detectors. They're not attack detectors. As a consequence, you get lots and lots of anomalies and lots of false positives. And at the end of the day, you know, it's just not worth it. You know, it's just yet another source of noise, is my experience. Well, I think machine learning really works on the defensive side if you have a very specific problem to solve. Tell me which log entries look similar to this one from a machine learning point of view. Tell me which domain DNS requests are probably generated by a domain DJ, you know, which are probably command and control servers. So if you have a very specific problem, they work well. I think the recursive Bayesian estimators are snake oil, personally. But I've made a statement, guys, but that's my view. Okay.
Hi. One of your slides mentioned deep fish, yes, using deep learning to bypass. Can you give some overview about it?
So what's happening is people are trying to use natural language processing to create automated phishing emails. You know, so effectively using NLP to create text to try to fish users automatically. You know, that shows promise, but there's a lot of debate about that at the moment, about open AI and the veracity and effectiveness of that technology. The examples are quite well chosen when they use them. I do think it does show promise, but I think, it's still a little bit longer to go. And the reality is this, is that you don't need machine learning to fish users right now. It's very simple. You know, I don't think machine learning adds to that. It might automate parts of it, but it's so simple to do. So I think that is showing promise in some area. And one observation I would say too, you know, in machine learning nowadays, if your thing doesn't have the word deep in it, it doesn't get the attention it deserves. You know, deep is like the cyber of the machine learning world. You know, so it's not everything has to be deep. But my view is it shows promise, but I don't think it's quite there yet. There's a question there? Yes. 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 Okay, so the question is around web application attacks using reinforcement learning. So reinforcement learning is basically a mechanism where the machine learning algorithm doesn't know, or the AI, it's probably the only proper use of AI, not machine learning. The algorithm doesn't know the application and use a reward-based system. So you try different things, and different things create different rewards and not. Okay? And what you then try to do is you're trying to maximize your reward. And so by this way, you can actually find your way around the application, and your reward might be error codes coming back from the application or a crash. So effectively what you're doing is it's like a little kid wildly keying stuff in. It's like a form of fuzzing almost, okay? And those things again show promise, but I've not seen any real practical examples of those yet. They're theoretical, and I've not shown them used in something that I could reproduce or scale. But I think those are coming too. Okay. Any other thoughts, observations, guys? Well, if not, thanks again for your time and attention. We really, really enjoyed it. You know, this was a really, really interesting journey for me and Wicus, and I'm happy to have shared that journey with you, and thanks for your time and attention. Thank you.